Good evening to all the participants. Welcome to the webinar. And a happy World Orangutan Day. And thank you for all the participants who have registered. Thank you, Ananda. It's a webinar, national webinar on orang utan, orangutan, rainforest and humans. It's a national webinar by Shaili Savant, Research Scholar, Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun, Uttarakhand, organized by Rajabalayam Rajesh College, Rajabalayam, and Wildlife Association of Rajabalayam. Welcome all the participants, and it's the time to intro our resource person. So happy to intro our resource person, Shaili Savant. He has a PhD scholar in Wildlife Institute of India and looking at social relationship and resource utilization pattern of resource masters. He did his master from Forest Research Institute, Dehradun. For master dissertation, he worked on Andaman serpent eagles and crested serpent eagles in the Andaman Island. Its native place is Sindhudurg, Maharashtra. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your acceptance, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Good evening, one and all. I'll directly go to my presentation because sir has already introduced me. So what do you understand by primates? What is a primate? So when Carl von Linne in 1707 to 1778, he was a Swedish botanist, and he was the first one to provide a definition for what constitutes a primate. And if you remember his great publication in 1758, Systema Naturae, where he has given a taxonomic classification of many species, he also suggested that primates can be recognized based on the presence of four anatomical traits, that is four incisors, two clavicles, two mammary glands, and at least two extremities that function like hands. This definition of primates were more or less the same for over 100 years until when an English anatomist, George Mivart, in 1873, provided a more extensive list of traits used to define a primate, which I have given here. That is, they have nails or claws, they have clavicles, they are placental mammals, they have eye sockets encircled by bones, incisors, canines, and molars are three different types of teeth, brain with posterior lobe and calcarine fissure, innermost digit of at least one pair of extremities opposable, that is the thumb, and the hallux with a flat nail, well-developed cavum, pendulous penis, scrotal testis, which is prominent in males, and two pectoral mammary glands. Then it was not until the English anatomist Gross Clark in 1959 suggested that there was a need to include evolutionary trends in a definition of primates. And in 1986, Robert Martin, an English anthropologist, put forth an even more comprehensive list of traits and suggested that we take into consideration such things as habitat adaptation, distribution, locomotor adaptation, and reproductive biology. So today what you have, the definition of primate is more holistic and it consists of all of these parts. Now, why study primates? Why do we have to study primates? So the first picture here, you see this picture. So this is Peerat Gawlick. This is Jane Goodall, and this is Diane Fossey, one of the bravest women in primatology. So all of you know Jane Goodall, she's been working on chimps. Diane Fossey worked on gorillas, and Red Kaltilax has been working on orangutans for 40 years, that is almost four decades. She did her PhD on orangutans. So the second picture you see here. The second picture here you see is that of a rhesus macaque. She's a female, one of the females from my troops in my campus, my study troops. And I don't know why, but she was just posing like that for some time, and I wanted to click that picture. The third picture here you see is us. This is me, this is one of our veterinarian and two of our students. This is us monitoring the health parameters of rhesus macaque, adult male rhesus macaques, when we were collaring the macaque. And the fourth picture is me taking the measurements of an adult female rhesus macaque when we were collaring her. So traditionally, non-human primates have been studied from the perspective of what we humans can gain from learning more about them. But non-human primates have been studied in order to understand the environmental circumstances behind evolution and human adaptation, how learning occurs, the effects that physical and social evolution and human adaptation and environments can have on behavior, and to increase our knowledge of functional morphology, neuroanatomy, and physiology. But today, the focus of much of the research on non-human primates has changed. Research projects are conducted with the specific goal to learn about a particular aspect of non-human primate species, or to better understand some component of that species. And the non-human primates are studied for the implicit reason of increasing our knowledge about them, their behavior, their ecology, the conservation of the species in the wild, their cognitive abilities, etc. Ultimately, however, their lives and ours are linked. And the more we learn about non-human primates, the more we ultimately know and understand about ourselves. So does that mean that the other species other than the primates are not as intelligent as primates? No, that's not the case. The only reason why we find primates more intelligent is because we've been studying more about them. And the reason is there's always a tendency to study something that is more like us. And we find resemblance to primates. Like, even a child can tell if a rhesus macaque or if any other monkey is behaving a certain way, even a child will be able to, you know, relate to that primate. So that's one reason why we find primates intelligent. But I'm sure other species of animals are also as intelligent as primates. Moving on. Now, here is the primate classification. So you have this in taxonomy, you have order, suborder, infraorder, parorder, superfamily, family, subfamily, and genus. Some people also add tribe, but I did not add it here. One thing I want to make clear is there are a lot of images and texts that I have used, which I do not own copyright, but I have added it. I have given the references in the later section. So I want your attention here. Hominoidea, Hylobatidae, and Hominidae, that is gibbons, orangutans, gorilla, chimpanzees, and humans. So we belong to the same superfamily as gorillas, chimpanzees, gibbons, and orangutans, that is Hominoidea. And if you see, we have some characteristics that are common. None of us have got tails, right? We have these long extremities. We can stand. And our tooth have these Y pattern, if you see. Now, coming to orangutans, what is an orangutan? Orangutan is also written as orangutan, 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 and orangutan. So it's derived, so this word orangutan is derived from the Malay words orang, that means man, and hutan means forest. There are three species of orangutans currently. The adult males may weigh, full-grown adult males may weigh up to 300 pounds, and full-grown adult females weigh almost half of it. The average height is 4 to 5 feet. The number of offspring that they produce is one. Very rarely have they produced twins. The gestation period is quite long, 8.5 to 9 months. It's almost the same as humans. And that's one reason why they are threatened, because they have such slow growth rate. That is, the gestation period is long, and the interbirth interval, that is the interval between two births, that is, if a female reaches sexual maturity at the age of 14 or 15, and after she gives birth to that offspring, she will only give birth to her next offspring after 8 to 9 years. And the average lifespan of orangutans is 30 years. Some have also lived up to 60 years, but on an average, it's 30 years, both in wild and in captivity. So this is a picture of a Bornean orangutan clicked in captivity by my friend Nilanjan Chatterjee during his recent trip to Borneo. Now coming to the distribution of orangutans, there are three species: Pongo abeli, Pongo tapinoliensis, and Pongo pygmaeusis. So the first one, that is Pongo abeli, is the Sumatran orangutan, and there are only 7,500 individuals in the wild. The second one is the one here, tapinoliensis. Where there are only 800 individuals remain in the wild and the status is critically endangered. And the third one is the Bornean orangutan. So the third, that is the Pongo tapinoliensis. This is the newest species of ape, the new species of orangutan that was recorded. And there were a lot of genetic and morphological differences from both these species. But this particular orangutan is found more closely related to the Bornean orangutan, and it was published by Nature et al. In 2017. So research on orangutans. Now very little was known about orangutans till Bayard Goldikas started studying orangutans in Borneo. So she was a student of Louis Leakey, who is a great anthropologist. And after doing her BA in psychology, she entered a graduate school at University of California to pursue a degree in anthropology. And there was a lecture of Leakey which Dr. Barrett attended. And she wanted to pursue her career in primatology. So that was when she actually started to pursue her career. And later on, like Jane Goodall and Diane Fossey, both Louis Leakey's students, she obtained some initial funding and she was sent to the Indonesian island of Borneo. And in 1971, at the age of 25, she began to work. And now it has been over four decades of her research on the red apes. Now, the activity and diet of orangutans. So most of the time, that is the 60 to 70% of the time of orangutans is spent in feeding. They are mostly frugivores. Durians is the most preferred food. So durians is this, it has got a very unusual smell, and it is, but it does have a great taste. I guess that's why they prefer it the most. And so if you look at the feeding time of these animals, orangutans, it's proportional to the availability of fruits in the forest. So for example, if there are more fruits, they'll feed for more time. If there are less fruits, they will rest more. So they use actually, they adapt to energy maximizing strategy during times of food shortage. So when there is food shortage, they'll go for, leaves, barks, and things like that for supplementing their diet. But they mostly depend on fruits. The other thing about these animals is they are semi-solitary. That is, they may not be as social as other primates, but confined when during the consortships when they mate, and usually males try to avoid each other, and in order to avoid each other when they're walking in the forest, they'll usually give out these huge loud calls so that the other males are also aware that they're walking. And the mother infant relationship in the orangutans is very, so the mothers even nurse their infants up to 9 years of age till the infant reaches, till that offspring reaches 9 years of age. So that's really a long time. And it is found that they avoid mating, or they avoid males. They're non-receptive to males during this period. So other thing about these apes is that they build nests at night using branches of trees for resting. And sometimes they are also seen building nests during daytimes for just a quick nap. But they do build nests for that even. They've seen using tools to break in nuts and for feeding for or any other things. And they've also been seen to use leaves and make use of leaves as napkins. And it's said that they must have learned that through other individuals or looking at humans, but that has been recorded in orangutans as well. So the home range, sorry about the spelling, the home range and daily movement. So it's very difficult to actually determine the home range of orangutans in the rainforest. But this was a study done by Campbell and et al. In 2011, where they found. So here, if you see, this is the MCP, that is the minimum convex polygon, 100% minimum convex polygon. And the kernel density estimates of the home ranges. So an adult female, this is in hectares. So 58 hectare. So the second adult female moved around 137. The home range was 137 hectares. Third adult female was 187, and so on. So if you look at the home ranges of males and females, the home ranges of males are larger than that of females. And if you look at the mean day length, even that, the males tend to move to longer lengths than the females. Now, coming to the habitat. So what is a rain? So the major habitat of orangutans is the tropical rainforest biome. So many primate species are found in the primary rainforest. And these primary rainforests are areas virtually undisturbed by humans, in which trees have matured over many centuries. And other primate species are adapted to less pristine conditions and are very successful in secondary rainforest. These forests that have regenerated after some natural or human-caused disturbances are called secondary rainforest. But So the lowland rainforest are those forests located below 1,000 meters, and the mountain or cloud forest are located above 1,000 meters. And the temperature, the climate is wet or humid in these, and they receive heavy rains. The rainfall is 2,000 mm per year. So I've already explained to you what is a primary rainforest and what is a secondary rainforest. Now, why are these incredible creatures endangered? What is the main issue of these? First thing, habitat destruction, that is illegal logging and felling of trees and palm oil plantations. So in the recent past, there have been lots of illegal logging activities in the rainforest of Southeast Asia. And the forest laws, there have been forest laws, but they are inadequate to, you know, contain these illegal for logging or felling activities. The second reason is hunting, that is poaching of orangutans. Orangutans are hunted. So sometimes what happens is when there is destruction of rainforest like this, orangutans tend to enter the human-dominated landscapes in search of fruits or food, just like any other primates. But it has started happening only in the recent past. So, and then the locals kill them, treating them as pests. And other thing is, the infants of these orangutans are captured and kept as pets. So they're illegally possessed as pets. And they're sent to Taiwan, China, and all these places. The fourth reason is the slow growth rate. That is, they bear an offspring only every 8 to 10 years, which is a really long period of time. So on an average, if an individual, if an adult female lives up to, say, 40 to 50 years, she can only give birth to 3 offsprings in her entire lifetime. So that's a really, really slow growth rate. And it's very difficult for these animals, you know, to survive. If the habitat is destroyed, if there is no fruit. And so there is this phenomenon of mast fruiting in the rainforest. So there'll be fruiting only for this, for some period of the year, and all trees will start fruiting. So when there is fruiting like that, what these animals do is they, you know, they eat maximum number of fruits possible. They'll have fruits in the hand, legs, and then they'll keep eating because they have to, you know, store that energy when because they know, because they are so intelligent, they know that there won't be any fruit in the later part, that is when there is no this thing, when there is no fruiting period. So they need to keep that, and they adapt to that energy maximization strategy. Now the deforestation that has occurred, if you see here, this is Borneo and this is Sumatra. So this was 1973 forest cover. And then this is forest clearance that took place from 1973 to 2010, these red areas. Now, if you remember the first map that I showed where there was the distribution of orangutans, you saw that the distribution was in these areas, right? But exactly now you see how the forest logging activities and plantations have taken place in these areas, means they have been in threat. The same goes with Sumatra as well. This was in 1990, 2000, 2005, and 2010. So studies show that almost 30 to 40% of the entire forest, entire orangutan habitat has been destroyed in the past few decades. Now, I just want to show you something here. Can you... sir, will you please tell me if you can see me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Audible, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Anyway, so... Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, can you see this, the
yes, ma'am.
Animation?
Yes, ma'am.
That... Yes, okay.
Yes, ma'am. Visualize.
Yes, yes. So this is the forest oil palm plantation and pulpwood plantation that has been taking place in the this thing in Borneo. And if you see from 1973 to 2015, the amount of forest, the number of forest that has gone, that has been depleted, and the rise in oil palm plantations and the pulpwood plantations. And even here, if you see the first map that I showed you, the distribution of orangutans was in these areas, and these are the same areas that have been destroyed by us humans. And for the sake of what? For the sake of oil palm oil plantations and pulpwood plantations, for the never ending human greed. So going back to my presentation. Now, so coming back to the palm oil industry, the single major threat for orangutan habitat today in the world is nothing but palm oil industry. And believe me or not, even I was shocked when I saw all these contents, you know, everything, when I saw all these things, even I was shocked, because these are the things that you see in your everyday products that you use. It may be vegetable, or it may be your cooking oil, it may be your shampoo, it may be your chocolate, or anything. And if you see this patch of rainforest, and then if you see this, these are the plantations, and these are the major reasons for destruction of orangutan habitats. And sometimes what happened is these products, the chocolate and the cooking oil, they only come under the label of under the ingredients. If you see, they'll only write vegetable oil, vegetable fat, or, you know, or something like that. But that is what? That is palm oil, most of the products. And why do they use palm oil? Because it requires less land when you compare it with sunflower or peanut oil, groundnut oil. Both these plants require large amount of land, but palm oil requires relatively less land when you compare it with these. But the destruction it does is, you know, you cannot bring back the forest once you have destroyed the forest. So I don't know how and when and how are we going to stop this thing, but the major aim for today's world or celebrating World Orangutan Day is to make people aware of all these facts. Yes, now this is one one food product that I hate the most, but although it's my personal opinion, and I have never had Nutella in life, trust me or not, this I've never had Nutella. But let me ask you one thing: are you ready to give up ice cream, chocolate, detergent, cooking oil, Nutella, packaged bread, soap, pizza dough, instant noodles, shampoo, lipstick, cookies? Okay, so the list is endless, but I have listed the major items, food items, and the other day-to-day items that contain palm oil. So now you cannot give away all of these things. You cannot, right? But what you can do is NGOs like WWF and Wildlife Trafficking and other organizations have partnered with various other organizations in the world. And they had this, you know, round table for sustainable palm oil plantations. So the palm oil, the palm plantations grown there are sustainable. Yes, although I don't really know how sustainable, but then still, but if you have these big NGOs working, then you can always trust them. So, and they have given these companies certification that, okay, so this palm oil, this product, if you're using this palm oil in your product, then it is certified by the Roundtable for Sustainable Palm Oil Plantations. So there are these products that come with a certification, but then you'll have to check those. So I don't think, but still in India, I don't think a lot of companies still have been certified to this Roundtable this thing. But still, I've put a picture of Nutella here because Nutella consists, the major ingredient of Nutella is palm oil. 20% is palm oil. It's because palm oil gives a different texture to Nutella, and it gives a thickness. So that's why you have palm oil in Nutella. But I don't know how many of you are ready to give up on Nutella. I have already given up. So yeah, so that's all I have for today. I hope I've been able to, you know, generate some awareness for you regarding palm oil and the orangutan habitat. And I hope in the coming years, all of us will together work towards conservation of orangutan. So these small baby steps that we take may help this big ape to survive so that even our coming generations will be able to see it. So the references that I've used, all the internet sources where I got the information from, acknowledgements. Thank you, Rajapalayam Raju's College, for giving me an opportunity to talk about orangutans. Thank you, Professor P.R. Ramji, for, you know, coordinating this session. Wildlife Institute of India, my alma mater. I thank Dr. Satya Kumar and Professor Kamar Qureshi, my PhD supervisors, for introducing me to this world of primates. I thank Deepan Chakravarti, Nilanjan Chatterjee for the photographs, Sudhanu Satpati, thank you. Friends and family members, and Piku and Jojo, my cats. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, thank you so much, ma'am.
I hope I've been able to do justice to the platform that you gave me, sir.
ma'am, this is what we need, ma'am.
Yes. Okay.
Ma'am, shall we go for a question session, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, there is a question from Dr. Kumaresh Behera. I think it displays in your screen, ma'am.
Yes, can you please throw some light on the learning ability of orangutan as they can learn different ASL? How does community learning occur? I'll try to answer this to the best of my knowledge, because the community learning, if you see, even in general, in primates, there is community learning. So if you observe any primate, for example, in India, we have the overabundant rhesus macaques. If you look at them, community learning is when they learn from their elders, that is from their adults. So usually, if you look at the behavior of infants and the subadults, they all follow what the adults and what the adults do, right? So if they see an adult going and feeding on a garbage dump, they'll go and feed on there. And if they see an adult jumping on trees, they'll do that. So that's how it is. It's almost like humans, right? Our babies, what do? They learn from us. So that is what is community learning. So I hope I have been able to answer your question, sir. So the next question, can you briefly explain your work of PhD? Oh, thank you. I would love to explain my work. So what I'm looking at is, social relationships and resource utilization patterns of rhesus macaques in the human-dominated landscape of Chandrabini. And what I'm trying to look at is how do these animals behave in the natural areas and in the human-dominated landscapes. So this study area that I have is a mosaic of three different habitats, that is urban and rural habitat, you have villages, and you have a forest as well. And these macaques tend to use these habitats in patches. So they'll sometimes spend more time in the forest, sometimes in the human-dominated landscape. And so my topic is food matters. And does peripatetic provisioning affect social relationship and resource utilization patterns in rhesus macaques? So peripatetic provisioning is nothing but when we provide food to the human to the animals in the form of garbage dumps, or we may directly feed them, or it may be agricultural crops, or it may be anything. Even there are a lot of debates going on this, the particular word peripatetic provisioning. Thing is, anything that we give to animals here, any food, anything in the form of garbage dumps or even our agricultural crops, or even if we just throw some food in our backyard, that is peripatetic provisioning, because for an animal is just food, it will just come and eat it. So that's what. So for my PhD, I am just trying to look at these differences, and also to see how they range, what are the home ranges in natural areas, in human dominated, what are the day lengths in human dominated landscapes and in natural areas, and feeding patterns as well. Sangeeta, have you seen any type of diseases frequently which cause death to these primates? Yes, ma'am, there are a lot of diseases that cause deaths to the primates, but I can tell you more about my rhesus. Right, so there was this one subadult male that I found, and it was limping all throughout the time, and it acted as if it was coughing. Okay, and I was observing that for that particular subadult male for a period of 10 days, and because I personally don't like to interfere into the natural state of the animal until and unless it's my study animal, like if I put a collar or anything on him, but otherwise I don't really like to interfere. So this particular individual was moving around, and eventually it was really difficult to find out what exactly happened. But what we suspect is either tuberculosis or some lung disease for that. And other primates, I have seen one female with rectal prolapse. Then there are many other primates who die of again tuberculosis and skin diseases mostly. But in my case, in my study area, my troops, they have died mostly because of accidents, hitting on a car, or fights, or all those things. Malaysia is the major palm oil producer in the world. Can you tell something about the status of orangutans in the country? The major what I showed you in my slides, that is the population in Borneo, in orangutan is mostly found only in Borneo, Sumatra. And both these, I've given you the population, the number of animals in this area. So that's the only place where orangutans are found. Initially, yes, they were found in the entire Southeast Asia, I guess, yeah. But over the years, their population is now restricted only to those two islands, Sumatra and Borneo. What do you think about joint forest management? How can we use it? Joint forest management in case of what? So joint forest management, I don't know. I mean, yeah, you can use in general to increase the forest cover. Like, it's obviously in India, it's used a lot. For primates, I don't really know, especially in case of India, I don't really know, because these primates, rhesus and bonnets, even if they have natural areas, they've started coming out of this forest in search of food in human-dominated landscapes. So I don't really know how joint forest management can be helpful with respect to primates in India. But in general, yes, anytime joint forest management is always helpful. Are orangutans nocturnal? Are they dangerous or aggressive? Do they have predators? I don't think they're nocturnal. They're mostly active during daytime because they build a nest at night for sleeping. And no, they are not dangerous. They are very, very, very shy creatures. They're very adorable. I mean, if you get a chance, I think you should go and visit Borneo and you should see orangutan for your life. Sir, what was the previous question? I think the last sentence I missed. Do they have predators? Yes, I think there they have the tiger, the native tiger that they have there. I guess Sumatran tiger, yeah. But I don't know if they really... And the other predators are, of course, us humans. But apart from the tiger, I don't think they have any other predator as such. Okay, next question. Is there any bioconservation reserve for orangutan protection? Yeah, so there are a lot of orangutan wildlife rescue centers in both Borneo and Sumatra. And also there are protected areas, but these protected areas fail to protect orangutans because of illegal logging. And, you know, a lot of foreign companies have started investing in these areas for timber and everything, for the timber purpose. And so there are conservation reserves, protected areas, but they don't really, you know, they're not really helpful as such. And even the forest personnel in these areas are not well equipped to fight poachers or these illegal traffickers or these people. The other threat is, I would say, there are a lot of forest fires that happen in these areas, and they are mostly due to forest clearings for rice fields. So this is another major threat for orangutan habitats in Borneo, Sumatra.
Ma'am, last question, ma'am.
Yeah, sure. Which animals are associated with orangutan at community level? At community level, I'll be able to answer that question, but I guess plants, mostly most of the plants that are associated, because there are few plants that don't germinate, that don't come until and unless the seed is passed through the gut of mammals. And in those rainforests is particularly this orangutan that feeds on these seeds, and then the seed then germinates. So there are major seed dispersers in the rainforest community. But otherwise, at community level, I'm not sure, sir. Sorry about that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Extremely thank you for your acceptance. And on this day, it's a special day for us to have such eminent person on this orangutan, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, dear participant, I have sent a mail. The feedback link. So don't worry about this. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.